So without further ado, we have Stephen Huber and Philip Ruskosh.
He will introduce us.
Okay, yeah. And please give them a warm welcome.
Okay. So hello to our talk about voice over IP configuration interface security. My name is Stefan. I'm a security researcher at the Fraunhofer Institute for Secure Information Technology. And I'm working there as a researcher for static and dynamic code analysis. And during my spare time, I'm working on IoT stuff. And with this talk, we want to share our new knowledge or experiences. I'm also one of the founder of a hacking team. It's called Team SIG, and it's a small hacking group from Fraunhofer.
Thank you, Stefan. Hello, my name is Philip. I'm also working at the Fraunhofer SIT in the Secure Software Engineering Department. And my main focus research is static code analysis and IoT vulnerability detection. And I'm also a member of Team SIG. First of all, some acknowledgement to Alexander Trout, Michael Tröger, and Andreas Wittmann, who supported us within this project. A short announcement, we brought some beer as we're from Germany, and it's not the first time for us. And we always brought beer, and if you have some questions or want to talk to us, you're welcome to join us after the talk. So in recent years, we had several projects, which we also presented here at DEF CON. You might check it out on our webpage. And after the last year's DEF CON, we wondered, how do we get here this year again, and we were thinking about a topic or a research subject with a wide distribution, a complex software, and which is readily accessible, because if you find bugs and nobody can exploit it, nobody cares about it. And we came up with voice over IP phones. So the distribution, I mean, it's in every office, on every desk, in every business, so the distribution is covered. On all of these phones runs a web server for management and configuration purposes, which is complex enough to build in bugs. And so this point is also covered. And the last point is the accessibility. I think in your business, the network is configured well, and the voice phones are in a separate network and not accessible by any other participants of the network. And of course, it's not accessible over the internet. But if you're familiar with how some companies handle their network, you might know this state where everything is put in one network, and the guests, the regular users, and sometimes also the people from the internet can access all of the devices. So the third point is also covered. These phones are accessible from a lot of people and also from a lot of attackers. So this talk is structured as follows. I will give some short background about these phones, then give an IoT hacking 101 to show you how we find our bugs, and then I will present some findings, and in the end I will conclude the talk. Starting with the background. Each of those phones runs has an ARM or MIPS CPU inside, and on top of it, it runs a Linux. There you have the basic init process, some watchdogs, the SIP daemon for the actual voice communication, and then finally the web server, which is used to configure all of this. And this web server is today our tech target. The methodology. When figuring out these bugs, we first set up the VoIP phones as a regular user or admin would do, so the web server is running. Afterwards, we attach a HTTP proxy and just clicking around and see if we find some bugs by just observing the traffic. If we don't find anything more there, we extract the firmware to perform some static analysis, for instance, some secrets or some scripts which we can easily exploit. In the end, for developing real exploits, an emulation comes in handy and other dynamic analysis tools which are good for finding the real interesting vulnerabilities. There's one exception when you're lucky, you find a way of injecting dynamic analysis tools directly on the phone, so you save the step of emulation. Here is an overview about some tools we used. You can check it out later when the slides are online. I won't go through them in detail here. So the first step, what you want to do after you did the web pen testing, you want to grab the firmware. And this firmware access is not always this easy. First of all, it's out of scope for us to desolder chips and induce complex and expensive hardware setups because we are software people. If we need to do this, we skip to another phone. So what did we do? First, we check the website of the vendor or the manufacturer to see whether we can download the complete firmware image from there. When you're lucky, you're done there. Sometimes you only get a diff or some patches to the base image already running on the phone, or it's encrypted and you cannot do something with the update package from the website. Then another way is to trigger the update from the phone if this function is available, and if you capture the traffic, you might be happy or lucky and you can get the firmware from there. But what we did most of the times was getting the firmware directly from the device because it's located there, and so you can grab it from there. We used some cheap hardware adapters like the JTAGulator or the Bus Pirate to connect directly to the chips. And this, for instance, can be done as I show you here. If you find a chip on the device, you may check the data sheet of this chip and see which ports or pins are provided. And if you find, for instance, the SPI interface, you can connect the Bus Pirate to it, which looks like this on the AccuBox, and then you can directly read from the chip over the interface by using several tools. Here is an example with the FlashROM tool, which we use to dump the firmware. After dumping the firmware, you can analyze as you wish, for instance, with BinWalk to extract all the data. As you see on the bottom, this is not the most stable connection, as every dump produces a different output, but in the end it did the job pretty well for us. Another way is the UART interface. If you find a UART connection on the phone, you may connect the JTAGulator as you see here in the picture, and then you can see what happens. Sometimes you get access to the bootloader, which has a minimum command set available, and if you're lucky, you can dump the flash memory from there with a dump command. This command is not always available, but when you're lucky, you get the firmware from there. But if you're more lucky, you get directly into a root shell and have access to all the data on the chip with this root shell. The third way is a vulnerability inside the web interface. For instance, if you find a command injection, you may start a telnet daemon, which allows you a connection to the phone with telnet. And as it's not intended to run, sometimes there's no authentication and you get a root shell directly. And then you can dump the data. As the software on-site the VoIP phones is limited and not made for dumping all the stuff, you need sometimes some tricks to get data on the phone, for instance, additional tools, or you need some tricks to get data off the phone after you found what's useful or what you want to investigate further. Here's an overview about some commands we used. You can check it out in the slides later. We won't go into detail here. The last step of the hacking 101 is the emulation. Once you got the firmware, you want to run it in an emulator to find the real interesting vulnerabilities. And for doing this, there are multiple ways. We focused on system mode emulation, which looks like this. We getting a QEMU emulator with the ARM or MIPS architecture and putting a Raspbian on top of it. Inside the Raspbian, we put a CH root environment with all the data from the firmware we need to run up the web server. And afterwards, we attach our dynamic analysis tools, for instance, a GDB server or GDB directly or S-Trace, in order to analyze the web server. Almost all the time, you need to patch the binaries you execute, as they are looking for some specific hardware interfaces which are only available on the phone but not on your emulator. You can do this in multiple ways, like hooking or patching with GDB. You need to be a little bit there are multiple ways of doing it. Now the fun part. I will go through some findings and starting with the denial of service. If you imagine these phones are located in critical infrastructures or hospitals, and the denial of service can cause pretty heavy damage or can cost lives. So denial of service is an attack you want to avoid. So the first thing we found is by nmap scanning the Mitel phone, you can cause a denial of service for around half an hour. So the hardware is so cheap and so limited that an nmap scan for a few seconds is enough to cause a denial of service. So you maybe want to spend a little bit more money on your hardware inside your phone. A little bit more interesting is this request at the Cisco phone. Can anybody guess what's the problem here? Right, it's the double quote in the GET request, which leads to an assertion fail and causes the phone to reboot. This denies the service for around 5 minutes, but then you can resend the request again and the phone is down forever. Whether this is good or bad error handling, everybody can decide on its own. As I mean, you avoid harder damage like remote code execution, but yeah, it's a denial of service attack. Afterwards, we looked at some known vulnerabilities, like a CVE from 2017, which causes out-of-bound reads in the OpenSSL library, which is used for the HTTPS connection for the web interface. And we found 4 phones which were vulnerable to this. And in some cases, the phone reboots. In other cases, just the web server crashes. But in any case, you should update your libraries, your third-party libraries, to save you trouble in this area. So another nice category is the bad crypto stuff. It's, I think, always present in every talk of us. Starting with the EchoBox. Within this phone, you can export all your configuration setting, including the SIP credentials and the credentials for the web interface. And they claim it's encrypted. As you see here, it's not plain text. But is it really encrypted? First thing we did is like checking whether it's base64 encoded, which it isn't. So maybe it's really encrypted. So we investigated further and extracted the firmware and found the implementation for the decryption of these credentials, and we found a phone AES decrypt method, and we were thinking of our crypto lectures and were able, or we was curious about auditing the AES encryption from them. But it turns out it's a self-implemented crypto, it's a simple substitution, and it's no AES at all. And so maybe we can break this crypto, but it turns out you don't need to break the crypto, you get the key for free because it's provided in the firmware image, and so it's not a secret. So coming to the classic web attacks, a classic, the XSS. I mean, by adding my favorite contact name into the audio codes, I get this. Just for completeness, I mean, we found it on several phones. Yeah, input sanitization is a thing. Keep doing it. Far more interesting is the GigaSet Maxwell Basic, where we found 2 interesting vulnerabilities. First of all, an information leakage by looking at the traffic. When asking this endpoint, it returns 2 different messages. And what does it actually mean? an attacker can ask the phone whether the admin is currently logged in or not. I mean, that's not nice, but it's not that bad, right? I mean, we just know that the admin is logged in, but it's not, as it's not state of the art, we digged a little bit deeper and found the implementation for this inside this snippet. I will explain it in detail here. Normally, the admin logs in, a session token is generated and stored for the, in the, inside the database to check the further requests from the admin whether he knows the session token. If an attacker asks the phone something, he does not know the session token, so he sends an invalid token. And what the phone does right here is it checks whether the currently logged in user is equal to user admin and whether the token which is provided is equal to the token stored in the database. And then it tells you that the admin is logged in, which is somehow weird because why would you tell somebody with an invalid token that the admin is logged in? So we digged a little bit deeper. We extracted the firmware, as you might have guessed already. It's a PHP implementation, so you can read the implementation pretty well. And we found how the session or the authorization process is handled. For every request, you provide a session token, and then it checks whether a user ID is behind the session token. And if the session token is greater than 0, you are allowed to do whatever you want to do. This is not nice, but it's somehow okay. So we digged a little bit more deeper and found the following. The post parameters function is used for setting all the several settings. And one of the settings is the admin password. So better secure this method. It starts as the last method. It checks whether a user ID is behind the session token you sent. And it provides 0 if the session token is invalid. And then it sets all the settings you want to give. So changing the password is possible for nearly everybody. Except the admin needs to be logged in as this post parameters function is only executed when a user is logged in. And this I will show you in a demo. So on the left top you see the victim and on the bottom you see the script from the attacker which just checks whether the admin is logged in with our first vulnerability, and then if it's logged in, it sends the request for changing the password. Now the script is running and it sees the admin is not logged in. Now the admin logs in with his 3-digit password and the script realizes that somebody logged in. And he directly changes the password. On top you will see that the admin is the real admin by, you see it right now. Interesting is also that when changing the password you don't need to know the old password. And now the admin logs out and the newly set password is 123456 and the attacker can log in and you see that and the change password interface, you see he's the admin. So that was it from my side. Now Stefan will continue with the rest of the findings.
Okay, thank you, Philip. So at first, a short introduction about path traversal. Who is not aware about this attack form? So imagine you have the web server, and the web servers can provide, or the web application can provide some files, or can write files by uploading. And for this file handling, in a request, the file name is send it to the application. Now imagine you as an attacker change the file name and, for instance, prepend some relative path information. If the web application does not verify this information or escaping or sanitizing it, it would be able for an attacker to escape from the default web server folder and can get access to different folder on the system. Such type of vulnerability we found on the Yealink device. So we can see here when we provide a few relative path information and the etc shadow file to the file parameter, the device responds with the hashes of the root user. This is possible because of two reasons. The first one, the input value is not verified, and the second reason is the web service is running as root. As we saw, the most, or we'll see, the most web services are running on root on our phones. But this is not enough. Currently, we can just read. What we want to reach is now somehow get remote code execution. So we have to upload files. One feature on the devices for uploading files is the ringtone upload. So our idea was now to use or override some script, which is you don't see the full text. Sorry, don't know why. The idea is now to override some scripting file, which will start at reboot. And the scripting file contains then our code we want to execute. But the problem was the upload feature, the upload or the overriding of the script file failed because the application verifies the file content and says, okay, this is not a script file. You have to upload some audio file. And that's why our overriding of the start script failed. But when we analyzed the software, we saw that the application just verifies a few bytes of the file header. What we did is we take a few bytes of the file header, prepended it to our script file, and then we were able to upload our file. When the file is executed or the script is executed, of course, the first three lines are recognized as an error. But the operating system still continues and our script will be executed. And so with this way, we get file access and could execute arbitrary code again as root on this device. Then we were scanning or looking for some kind of backdoors on the phones. We scan the ACOBOX device and saw, okay, there's a telnet port open. So the first question was, is it running by default? Can we turn it off? Or why is it running? We don't know why it's running, but you cannot turn it off. There's no configuration on the web interface, nothing. So this thing is running by default. The other thing is now to get somehow access, we need the password. The firmware image of this device is not public available. We looked in different forums or on the website. It's a Linux image, but it's not public available. But as Philip already explained, we get some image dump via SPA. And when we extracted the file system, here you can see these are the password hashes. And when you're a bit aware of password hashes, you will realize this is a DES script protection. And the problem of DES script is the maximum password length is 8. I have an old GPU on my office computer around 4 or 5 years, and it took me 30 days to crack it. So you can imagine if you have a new or a more modern device, you can crack this in a few days. And when you know the root password or the admin password, you can log into this device. By design. Command injections, another type of vulnerability. We found this type of vulnerability on 7 or 8 different phones. At first, a short explanation how it's working. Few of the, or the most phones provide in their web interface some diagnostic tools where you can, for instance, ping or enter an IP address, and then the phone will ping the IP address in the network. This should verify that the device is connected and working. So you enter the IP address. The IP address is forwarded to the web application, and the web application constructs a command, and this command then is forwarded to the libc system function, and the function is executing our command. So here you see our ping. So what will now happen if you, for instance, append additional comments with a semicolon and there is no sanitation? You can see the input is forwarded again to our application. combined to one command and executed. So here you will see at first we will do zero pings because the minus C zero says zero pings. Then with the semicolon the command is finished. Then we execute a ls and the rest is commented out and so not executed anymore. So this is the idea of command injection. We found a lot of this type of vulnerability on the devices. We will just explain one here of our findings. So we had an audio codecs device and there we can execute the telnet daemon again via command injection and then try to get some access via telnet. The problem here is you can see you need a basic authentication. So when you don't know as an attacker the credentials, this can be a problem. Later we will show a few information from our study on the most devices. You can try the old admin and it works. But this is not the intention of the attack. We also tried somehow to bypass the authorization, but we failed. So we searched another way to get somehow access to the device. And what we saw is there is also a change password feature on the phone. Here you see the request. And what you see is, you see nothing. The first thing is there's no authorization header here. So this means everybody can trigger this request to change the password. But then you can argue, okay, the attacker still has to know the old password. But same story, you see we have a parameter, an admin, this is our user. Then we have the new password and we have to verify the new password. This means that you don't have to know the old password. So now as an attacker you can change the password of every user and we also have a command injection where we have to know the password. So when we combine this you can say everybody can change a password and you can trigger remote code. We will show this in a short demo. So here you now see the original admin, he's logging in. To verify the original admin password you see here, it's from the authorization request, it's base64 encoded and you see the original admin password is superpass. So now we log out. Here you see now our attacker script. And the attacker script will at first change this password superpass to pass and in the second step it will execute our command injection with the new set password. We'll show that the new password pass looks base64 encoded in this way and you see this is matching on our request. Yeah. It's not finished yet. Give me a second. So now we try to trigger our exploit on the device. But at first we have to verify, you see there is no telnet running. So there is no telnet service. So then we execute the exploit. So password changing, the ping, login, admin, password is pass. And again we get a root shell because the service is running again as root. So, okay, thank you. Sometimes shit happens and shit happens brings us to stack based buffer overflows. We found on different devices buffer overflows. In our abstract we announced some ARM based but we also have MIPS devices and MIPS is a bit is more rare so we decided to explain the MIPS attack. Here you see one of the buffer overflows. I have to mention this is not a pre-auth overflow. You have to know or you have to be at least a user, but then you can use the buffer overflow to escalate your privileges and get root. By the way, this bug or vulnerability is not fixed. Here you see to change again the password, there is a set security password command. And the internal code you see on the one side we have a target buffer with 32 bytes and our input is forwarded as a parameter and used in a copy to command string function. You can imagine it sounds like already like some string copy and when we look into this implementation of the command string function you see this is a simple while loop just writing each character into our buffer and the loop only stops on a bracket or on the null value. So it's a buffer overflow. You find it in each college textbook. And here you see an excerpt of the GDB or of the debugging. You see we can control two registers. The most important is the return address. So we can control the program counter, jump to our code. And I will explain a bit more now how we get a final exploit. So one challenge when you try to exploit such a device is how do you bypass mitigations like NX, ALS error, and so on. This was very easy. There is no mitigation. Then we were a bit lazy and at first decided, okay, we don't want to write MIPS shellcode by hand because I'm not a MIPS guy. It would be too hard, so we auto-generated our shellcode. The next step is we have to find the stack address on ARM exploitation. You simply make or use the branch to stack pointer gadget, or on x86 you make a jump to ESP. Best of my knowledge, that there is not such a gadget in MIPS, so we have to build it or simulate by other gadgets, and we found two useful gadgets. The first one simply use an add operation to write the stack pointer to the address A0. Then we jump to our second gadget. This moves the A0 to T9, and then we can jump to T9, where our address of the stack pointer plus 32-byte offset. So with these two gadgets, we simply find our stack, where our shellcode will be. We also have somehow to handle the bad characters. This means when our shellcode contains this type of characters, it will not be written completely to the stack. So we have to somehow encode or obfuscate them. So for this, we use simply XOR encryption or encoding. We took this idea from a good paper. It's from Jung Yang from Vantage Point. He wrote a very good white paper about MIPS exploitation. So if you're working in this field, it's worth to read it. And with all this, we can now design our final exploit. You see the payload structure. We have a few byte padding, our two gadgets, the decoder, and then our shellcode. But there's another challenge, especially on MIPS and sometimes on ARM. So here you can see this would be our stack layout. You see the decoder and our instructions. Here you see two add operations, which should be just an example for our shellcode. So now our decoder will modify the code in memory. But on the most MIPS CPU, you have different types of caching. On the one side, you have the data cache, and you have the instruction cache. And when you modify the code in the memory, the data cache is modified, but the instruction cache not. And when you try to execute the code, the instruction cache is executed, but not the data cache. So our modification is not triggered, and our shellcode failed. So we get back and tried to fix the problem. There are two recommendations. On the one side, there is a clear cache function, but we did not find any gadgets on our device. Another option is to use the sleep function to trigger a cache flush. We also tried this, but after a few days, we still failed. I don't know the reason, but then we decided, okay, back to roots, and we decided simply to write our shellcode by hand and try to avoid null bytes or other bad characters. I want to give a few hints or what you can do to avoid this. Here, for instance, you see instruction, load immediate instruction to write a constant value to a register. And some MIPS instruction have by design a null byte included. So you can simply split it up, use some negative value, inverting, and so on, and play around. And then you will get also your final result. And this is null byte free. For setting zero values, classic trick, some XOR function, XOR two registers, and in your target register, you get your null, and this instruction is also null byte free. It's sometimes, especially when you need strings or other characters, it can get a bit complicated, but there we also use the XORing. This means we took our string value, XORed it already with a constant value, put this as our baseline, and then we can XOR it again during runtime, and then during the runtime we have again our string, and so we can bypass the decoding thing and the shadow cache problem. After that, we put everything in an assembler. In this case, it was a good online assembler. We got our big endian assembly and can put this in our exploit script. Here we'll show you a short demo. So in the lower window, you will see our reverse shell listening. In the upper window, this will execute our attack script. You see, okay, our target device is online. Here you see the script. It's written in Bash. Here you can see in the upper side our padding, our two gadgets, and then our handcrafted reverse shell. We will put this code also online. So I think in the video it's hard to see, but we also have written some advisory containing the code. You see again our exploit is executed. We are on the device. You see it in the lower window. We have access to the passvd and so on. We are again root because we already know all web services are running as root. Okay. Here you see a small overview of the devices we analyzed. We had a lot of findings. The most critical findings, we also announced CVEs. For the minor findings, we did not. So this is overview just for completeness. Below you find a link where we all uploaded all advisories we sent to the manufacturer. They also contain our exploits, scripts, and everything. So if you're interested, you can read it. Here is again the overview of the vulnerability and the devices. As we can see, we found a lot of command injections, path traversal, a few buffer overflows, sometimes also a few classic web-based attacks. When you look at short session ID, we had one web server which is generating a session ID with the length of 3 characters. So we can say this session is very short. We also were curious how much devices or phones are out there, but you will not get any numbers from the manufacturer. And as Philip already explained, normally these devices should not be reachable from outside. It's more a problem from an attacker from the inside. But we still made a short Shodan scan, and here you see the top 4 devices, and you see nearly over 10,000 devices were still reachable, or this web interface reachable. We also made a few sample tests if they use default credentials, and we found also devices with default credentials. So you should take care about this problem because this can be an entry point to your company network when someone abuses or attacks the published or leaked device. At the end, you always should give a few recommendations. I think the most are aware of this. You don't use default credentials. Keep the firmware update. You don't need a telnet server on a VoIP phone. Even if you have a web server, try to isolate it. There are a few phones where you can also disable it. When you don't need it, disable it. And also, as we already mentioned, network protection. Try to isolate your VoIP network. Also for developers, there are features called RISLR NX. Activate the compiler flags. No hard-coded keys. And also when you implement updates, what we saw is there's just a manual update mechanism. So implement some auto-update. It would be helpful. So this is now the end of the technical part. So at the end, a small summary. And I think the most already asked you or wondered why we have such back to the future images in it. In the last part of the documentation, we will make a short time travel to a few historical IT moments. You will see why. So when we go back to 92 or 91, everybody knows Linux was released, and from the concept, we have a multi-user system, we have process isolation, so it was a good idea and a good baseline. So 96, then someone realized, okay, there are some bad C functions, we have a problem, we must do something. So different mitigations were introduced, NX protection, ASLR, now we also have control flow, integrity, relog, and so on. So you can say from this time you have a good desktop PC. I think, of course, it's not bulletproof, you still can exploit it, but It was harder to attack. Then when we now will go to the year 2007, we get new generation of devices. Everybody knows there are smartphones now. And what we see when the devices were released, again, everything was running as root with one user. Okay, we realized this is not such a good idea. What have we done? 2010, we introduced again mitigation techniques. So we missed our chance to produce new designs or protection mechanisms. Now we arrived today, or the last 2-3 years, we are now in the time where IoT is in the focus. And when you listened or saw our vulnerabilities or read in the news, where are we? The state of 92. So in our opinion, something went wrong. And so you have to think when you use your web phone on the desk, in some cases, you're using technology which is on the security state from 28 years before now. Of course, we made responsible disclosure, we informed all vendors about our findings. We gave them 90 days or more to fix the bug. But sometimes also responsible disclosure can be a hard journey. Here you see a few reactions. I have to mention, of course, most cooperated and also tried to fix the problem. But the first reactions sometimes were, why are you investigating our poor phones? What should you say? Yeah, because we can. Sometimes they just argue, yeah, the device is not supported anymore. This is not our problem. I would say, yeah, it's your problem because your customers still use it. And sometimes you just have to argue. For instance, explain that you will publish all your findings on DEF CON and thousands of people will listen, and suddenly everything goes a bit faster. I already mentioned the buffer overflow was not fixed. We had two vendors which did not react to our announcement. One was HTEC, the other was AccuBox. We tried to contact them via email, via support, via Twitter, via Facebook, via LinkedIn. The only thing we did not was going to China, but if someone is here from the company, he can contact us. We will give him more details. At the end, we had different. We had 32 type of different phones. All in all, we found 40 vulnerabilities. The most critical, we registered CVs, so you can look it up. We realized during the project, there's a lot of old technology out there. But on the other side, especially when you look at the newer models or at the premium, flagship, hyper, whatever, super phones, you see there's a change. There are newer phones are running, for instance, with Android, which can be good because you have process isolation, sandbox, SE Linux by design, which makes it more secure. But on the other side, you have now the feature to install apps. So when you install on your desk phone, some apps, you can, how can I say, you can bring in new attack or vulnerabilities in the installed apps. And the question is now, do you really need a web browser or WhatsApp on your web phone? So I think this is the end of our journey. So as Philip already announced, if you have some questions or want to talk to us, come to the front. Grab some beer. If you have no question, just thirsty, also grab a beer. We brought them from Germany. It's good Munich beer. And so I can only say thank you for your attention. Here you see our contact address.